today we'll be talking a bit about energy. So what is energy? Energy is the amount of work that can be performed by a system. But where does energy come from? It comes from lots of different spots. Perhaps the most common are from fossil fuels, also from nuclear, and then there are a variety of other ones: sun, wind, tides, geothermal. The last of those groups are generally considered to be renewable resources. Ultimately, though, everything, all of these are on a scale from completely renewable down to not renewable at all. For example, you might consider solar energy to be renewable, and that's true on the scale of the human species, but if you were to think about it in terms of billions of years, it's not necessarily renewable because at some point the sun will burn out. Nevertheless, fossil fuels and nuclear are seen as non-renewable, whereas sun, wind, and tides and similar are seen as renewable energy sources. So gasoline, which comes from oil, is one of the main energy sources that many of you encounter in the form of, it's what makes your car go. Gasoline is mostly composed of hydrocarbons, which are groups of carbon atoms that are attached in a chain with a bunch of hydrogen atoms around them. So for example, heptane, which is one of the things that makes up gasoline, is 7 carbon atoms attached to each other with a bunch of hydrogens around them. But octane, which is another thing, and when you go to get gas and it says, like, you know, percent octane, 89 octane, this is the octane they're talking about, it's 8 carbon atoms in a row surrounded by hydrogens. And so I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about the process by which energy is released by octane combustion. So here we see an octane atom, or actually two octane molecules, as well as the chemical formula for the octane combustion process. And this is an exothermic reaction, one that gives off heat. So essentially what happens is that all of these octane molecules and a bunch of O2 molecules are in the same spot, and a chemical reaction happens where two of the hydrogens and one of the oxygens branch off and become an H2O, and one of the carbons and two oxygens become a carbon dioxide. And so this is why from the octane combustion you get CO2 and H2O. So the water comes out as water vapor out of your tailpipe, and the CO2 is what is the reason that fossil fuels lead to significant greenhouse gas production. So here we see a chart of the U.S. energy usage in 2012. And so on the left-hand side, there are all the different sources of energy, and on the right-hand side, they're where they go. So petroleum is the dark green one at the bottom, and it mostly goes to transport. And renewables tend to be they're the small ones up the top. And one thing that's striking about this, this graph is that about half of all of the energy that gets used goes to waste. So the little gray, or the gray box at the top, the light gray box at the top right, is called rejected energy. And the bottom darker gray box is energy services. So that I found really striking, that about half of all of the energy we use goes to waste, either as excess heat or other forms of waste. And in particular, electricity generation, which is the top sort of yellowish box, and transportation, which is the bottom pink box, are profoundly inefficient. You can see the light gray coming out of each one of those, and it's significantly bigger than the energy that is actually being utilized by people from those processes. So there's a book title that I find really interesting in terms of thinking about fossil fuels. It's called The Last Hours of Ancient Sunlight. And what this book title points out is that fossil fuels are ultimately the residue of ancient sunlight that fell on the Earth. Over millions of years, sun shined down and was absorbed by plants and produced photosynthesis, which is where the energy came from that was then buried under the Earth and compressed into oil, natural gas, and coal. And so what this book title suggests is that we are now using the last hours of ancient sunlight, that we are running out of all of this ancient sunlight that has been stored underneath the Earth from photosynthesis going on across millions of years. One thing that these fossil fuels have supported is a thing called the cognitive surplus. And this is something that came out of that a researcher named Clay Shirky from NYU thought up. He ties this back to the Industrial Revolution. that in the Industrial Revolution, humans started to use more and more machines to do the things that previously human labor had done. And what this caused, as people had to do less and less work to get the food and other resources that we relied upon, is that freed up a lot of time. And he calls this collective group of time that everybody has, the free time, the cognitive surplus. And what he suggests is that in the Industrial Revolution, when people didn't know what to do with this cognitive surplus, they turned to gin. And they went on a decades-long bender where gin effectively absorbed the excess time. And he makes a comparison between gin in the Industrial Revolution and currently things like television and a lot of discretionary internet use as being the thing that we do to occupy these vast hours that we no longer have to be out hoeing the ground and picking, you know, finding roots and berries and stuff. And he coins in this work a new unit of measure, which he calls the Wikipedia. A Wikipedia is about 100 million hours of human thought. That, he says, as a back of the envelope calculation, is about how much work went into all aspects of Wikipedia. That's writing all the code, every edit to every article that's ever been done. It's about 100 million hours, which seems like a lot. I mean, Wikipedia is a big production. But what he suggests is that we have about 2,000 Wikipedias worth of time watching television every year around the world. He suggests that we watch a Wikipedia worth of ads every weekend in the United States alone. And this was actually a conservative estimate, since his writing it up as 2,000 Wikipedias. Some other analyses could point to the idea that it might be 5,000 Wikipedias every year of TV. And he calls this big batch of free time the cognitive surplus. And what some of his research has been doing is looking at what should we be doing with it. And he discusses the notion that participatory culture is one of the things that's arising from the surplus. Participatory culture being the creation of things on the internet, everything from cat videos up to Kickstarter and Amazon Mechanical Turk are all parts of this participatory culture. In his book, Clay Shirky talks about using this cognitive surplus for civic benefits, for promoting various different causes and making the world a better place in an assortment of ways. He doesn't explicitly mention sustainability, but it could certainly be one of these items. Ultimately, though, where does the cognitive surplus come from? This is an important question. And what I would offer is that the cognitive surplus comes from labor-saving devices, and those labor-saving devices are using the energy from coal, oil, and natural gas to enable them. So ultimately, the cognitive surplus is made out of fossil fuels. So in terms of preparing for the future, if there's some possibility that fossil fuels might become scarce, as many researchers are suggesting, the cognitive surplus might become scarce as well, that we humans will need to spend more time in the satisfaction of basic human needs rather than having all of this free time to be building web pages and such. So what one approach that I would encourage is using the current cognitive surplus to reduce future reliance on the cognitive surplus. So effectively to try to take the cognitive surplus out of the critical path so that we don't necessarily need it. Because if it's so reliant on fossil fuels, and if those fossil fuels dry up, we won't necessarily have it at our disposal. And it seems like it's better to figure that out now than at a later date.